think one of the things that I thought was really important when I... There are various bits in careers where no matter how much you know about Victorian literature or something, you need someone to tell you how to do something, like how to write a book contract or how to write a CV or how to do a first lecture. And like no one tells you that. And it's very hard to get people to tell you that. And often it's because they don't really know themselves how they did it. Or someone did it for them sometimes. So I think that's really... So speaking openly is sort of thinking about something like that. Because I suppose one of the things I have... I had various thoughts what to talk about in this talk. And one of them was to... I've got various things pinned to the wall above my desk. And one of them is a quotation from... one of those education development magazines, from somebody saying, if you know your subject, you don't have to know your subject, you have to know what's outside your subject, meaning where your subject sort of nestles. So you have to know what it means, what effects it has, and how it works outside of just knowing about Victorian literature or something. But I'm not going to talk about that today. I've only got four things to say, really. I'm going to talk about... what is English today, and sort of what is English tomorrow, my sort of thoughts about it. And I feel a bit of a fraud doing it, because everyone, we're all professionals, we all have ideas about what it is English is and what it's doing, and thoughts about it. So, I'd rather you feel free to interrupt, okay? That's what I meant to be something, basically. So here are my introductory thoughts. One of the things about English is that, so here's the introduction to my lecture. One of the things about English is that no one really knows what it is. Okay, and I've got a whole list of things that it might be. A tool of British power, English as heritage, English as emancipator, English as philology, English as, this is from Henry Newbolt, English teachers are missionaries, and literature is not just a subject for academic study, but one of the chief temples of the human spirit, which all should worship. So English, English as religion, English as the science of literature, English as openness to life, English as a curator of the Museum of Literature, English as revolutionary, English as emancipator without limits, English as cultural politics, English as philosophy, English as therapy. I was thinking particularly of things like medical humanities, which here we are in King's, one of the homes of the medical humanities. English as a literature as a therapy, English as doing therapy. So all these sorts of things English is. And then... sometimes people worry about, well, what is it? What is it? What is it we do? And I always think of this quote. I always think of this quotation from Wittgenstein. I have this useful quotation from Wittgenstein about to hand, and he says, "Why do we call something number? Like why do we call it numbers? Well, perhaps because it has a direct relationship with several things that have hitherto been called number. You could change number for English. Hitherto been called English. And this can be said to give it an indirect relationship to other things we call by the same name." And we extend our concept of number, of English, as in spinning a thread, we twist fibre on fibre. And the strength of the thread does not reside in the fact that one fibre runs through its whole length, but in the overlapping of many fibres. So I find myself completely unfussed that no one knows what English is, and that when you, in your departments, or in my department, everyone has a different conception of what English might be, okay? Because it makes it, altogether, it makes quite a strong fibre. And sometimes you can peel fibres out of that rope, and sometimes you can weave new fibres in, and it's still quite a strong thing. So instead of thinking, oh, despair, I can't know what it is, I think it's really rather nice that it's all these sorts of things. So I feel pretty optimistic about English. I know it's a difficult time. I'll come to that in a second. And I think that, I'll still do my introduction, I think in higher education, I think people know more about this than I do, but it seems to me the institutional structures for English are pretty strong. English is a very strong A level, I'll talk about that a bit later, and the English departments are quite strong in my university, but I think in all over, English departments are quite strong, quite recognised. And so people know what English is. You don't often have to explain, you might have to explain what your research specialism is, but if you say you teach in an English department, most people sort of have a sense of, you know, you've read some of Shakespeare's novels, that sort of thing, you know? And I also think, here I think miserable, you know when you go to Hay on Wye, and you go to all second-hand bookshops, and you see where disciplines have gone to die, okay? And you go there, and again, I feel so bad saying this, King's Theology Department is one of the leading theology departments probably in the world, So I feel bad to say theology is a dead discipline, because there are people who do really interesting work in it. But it's not what it used to be. If you go to Hay on Wye, you'll find millions of books of theology published in the 19th century and early 20th century, okay, when it was really a kicking discipline. Okay, and now, if English is going to die, it'll take a long time, and you'll all be retired before it does. Okay, so we haven't got to worry for our lives. But that said, just because it's not going to die doesn't mean it's not changing. And I think it's a position, I think it's time of really interesting change at the moment. And in fact, I say that out loud. As soon as I say it out loud, I remember when I was a graduate student, I looked in part about the history of English as a subject, and everyone all the time said it was in a period of change. It was always in change, always in crisis. So it's always a period of change. And so I'm trying to think about this change that's in at the moment. Okay. But before I do that, I'm going to read this one of my very favourite quotations from the late Harold Rosen, who was he taught at the Institute of Education. He was he worked in education, but worked in English in education. I love this quotation. He said, "English is the least subject-like of subjects." Okay, but it's still a subject. It's just the least subject-like of subjects. "The least susceptible to definition by reference to the accumulation of wisdom within a single academic discipline. No single set of informing ideas dominate its heartland. No one can confidently map its frontiers. It colonizes and is colonized. When we inspect the practices which cluster together uncomfortably under its banner, they appear so diverse, contradictory, arbitrary, and random as to defy analysis and explanation. If, however, we interrogate and scrutinize this chaos illumined by flashes of lightning, we may perceive more meaning than meets the eye." Now, I was hoping that the four things I have to say would cohere in some sort of meaning, but they don't, okay? But that's the idea. I want to think about four things about English today. And I think the most important one, the most important change, I think, and you know better than I do, is about creative writing. Now, I understand about half of you teach creative writing, English in creative writing, and this is a phenomenal revolution that has swept through this discipline in this country. And I think it's, for the last 3 or 4 years, about half the jobs advertised on jobs.ac.uk have been creative writing jobs. And it's a phenomenal change. And I think a friend of mine works in what's called change management, and she said she should have above her desk a sign saying, "People hate change." Okay? So people do hate change, but I think the change that creative writing is bringing, we need to investigate. When I was younger, I was very opposed to creative writing. I thought it was a really bad thing. And then I had we had one of these department away days. This is about 10 years ago. And we were talking about whether we should have some creative writing in our department. And one of our very senior members of staff, who I would thought would be very opposed to creative writing, who's now retired, he gave a very cogent sort of argument for why we should have creative writing. And he ended up with saying, well, the students really want it. And he has a moment of Damascus. And I remember that when I was doing my degree, a man called Greville Lindop said to me, well, if you want to understand sonnets, you should try writing one. And it seemed such a weird and peculiar idea, but obviously it was completely right. And I'm now very, very pro creative writing. But I think there are interesting things to talk about it. One of the reasons I'm pro it, I think, is when I came to understand the revolution in creative writing as rather like the introduction of theory in the 80s. Theory in the 80s also revolutionized discipline in this country. Okay? And one of the things about theory, people like me are supposed to be open to the future and thinking about what might happen next. So it seems pretty ill-behaved to say, oh, creative writing, very bad. But you're supposed to be open to the future. And of course, the future is never what you expect. And so I don't think people expected creative writing to take off so much. And I think people are still finding their way about it a bit. I speak from my department, we have very well integrated creative writers. Is that where I'm putting it? We have lots of creative writers and we you know, it seems to work pretty well. Integrated sounds like we've eaten them. I don't quite mean it that way. So it's a huge change in discipline. And I think you've got in your folders a fantastic article by Ben. What's it called?
intelligence and interrogation, the identity of the English student, and it's the first thing.
Which I really, really recommend to you. I spent half an hour this afternoon searching around my study for my copy of it, and I can't find it anywhere. I filed it in the wrong, place. I know, I was. It's not on, I couldn't get it on our JSTOR either. I was pulling my hair out. Because one of the things it does, that fantastic article does, is it lays out the sort of, I'm going to read this paragraph, okay, which I got off the internet. Learners were socialised. Okay, it's about how students were socialised into their education, not just by learning about Middlemarch and stuff like that, but by the practices and processes and sort of ideologies of teaching, both of, so as it were, old-fashioned criticism, okay, and by newfangled theory. It's not newfangled anymore, but from the 80s, as it were. And they're both there are differences, of course, but there are also learners were socialised into a sense of belonging through rituals of oppression. In one case, like old-time criticism, the perceived perils of, that's Ben, my phrase, not Ben's, okay, old-time criticism, the perceived perils of mass culture. In the other, the collusions attributed to the chief practitioners of their own disciplines. And in the article, you find there's a really cool, useful column about differences and similarities between students studying literary criticism and students studying theory and how they're formed. And I think there's a really interesting column to be written about the students who've done creative writing, either just creative writing or English and creative writing, because they are different sorts of student. There are profound differences. I've taught various third year courses which have both English and English and creative writing students in, and there are differences between them. And I think that the key difference is the thing I'm deeply, deeply envious of as a sort of straight English teacher, is that one of the reasons I always liked English was because when you read a book and come out with your interpretation of it, it's sort of you doing it. You had to put yourself on the line, okay? But of course I discovered, when I was a student, I discovered also among my students that you can get away with just parroting stuff. You know, you can say this Shakespeare comedy, yada, 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 because you were too busy doing something else that week or that term, okay? Whereas in creative writing, okay, that's really, really hard to do. I imagine it can be done, but it's really hard to do. And the basic tool of creative writing, the sort of feedback workshop-y, seminar-y type thing, whatever it's called, okay, where people read their work and it's critiqued, that means that people have to sort of stand behind their work and they have to sort of stand out from themselves in a way which is the very best thing about education. And I try and do that in my English seminars, of course, okay? But of course there are people who can not do that and just get through. I think in creative writing, and I think also in drama, that's really, really, really hard to do. And that is fantastic. And that's about sort of taking responsibility for yourself. It's inculcated by the creative writing practice, and it makes for a really committed sort of student. And I am deeply envious of that. Okay, I think that's fantastic. Okay, so that's the main benefit. I think that's one of the reasons I love that. Is I think it's almost like I was making fun of old-time criticism, but one of the things about the whole Leavis and his whole generation was that then for doing English was something terribly, terribly important and significant for the whole society and for the individual. And I think that's a really, that thing about creative writing almost recovers that sort of idea, this terrible importance of it. Okay? And of course that can be misled, that can be like, oh, I want to be a great writer, or I'm expressing my soul, and yada, yada, yada. But that thing about responsibility is really important, so I love that. And this leads to some of the other sorts of strengths that I've seen in the English and creative writing students. They have a great self-confidence. I also taught English and drama students. They also have a great self-confidence from, I think, coming from the same place where they're critiqued and they have to learn to cope with their critique and they have to take responsibility for themselves. And they also have a great sense of ownership. It seems to me the English and creative writing students I've taught on my third year course on Salman Rushdie feel they own it much more than just the straightforward English students. And that, again, I'm envious of. Okay. Interestingly, I have found no difference between in English or Croatian for writing students in reading skills or writing skills. Okay? For example, I do a creative critical rewriting exercise. I make all the students write a pastiche paragraph of Salman Rushdie. Goes down a storm. The students all really enjoy it. The ones the creative writing students write and the ones the English students write, there is no difference between them. Okay? The creative writing students who somehow you'd think would have, perhaps what I would think in my stereotype way, would have a better sense of how sentences work and fit together, just don't. So there seems to be no differences in their sort of reading and writing skills. And of course, there also are going to be I've written here weaknesses, that's not the right word. There are also going to be differences between this new English student who's done more creative writing and the English student who just did literary theory and the English student who just read novels and what have you. Okay? I think one of the differences, of course, is that the creative writing students have less range. They've read less. Okay? Because they spend their time writing stuff. So they haven't read. They might have read Paradise Lost, but they won't have read Paradise Regained. That was really easy, wasn't it? They won't have read Comus. Do you know what I mean? There's stuff they won't have read. That also goes, sadly, for theory stuff. I feel bad saying this in front of Kristen, because I know she's just very theorized sort of teaching. But it also means that they won't have done all sorts of theory things. Two of my third-year students do creative writing. Talked quite blithely about authorial intention, and not only did my jaw drop, the jaw of everybody else in the seminar room just dropped. So I thought, like, did we not deprogram you from this? I thought in my 80s theory kind of way. So range, and also the thing about self-confidence, okay? Self-confidence is really good, but it can also mislead, all right? So it's good to be a self-confident student, but it's also, you can also go like, well, yeah, it might help if you read some secondary criticism too. All right? So, I mean, this is a playoff. So, there's some weaknesses. And I suppose I was also thinking, this is my last thing about creative writing, is of all these strands that come into English, I think one of the main things I like about creative writers in my department, and ones I've met through them, is they're quite committed, it seems to me, and I'm happy to be corrected about this, that they think of creative writing as being part of this big rope of English, one of the threads involved in it. I know in the States it's a separate discipline, but I sort of feel it shouldn't be. It's like another way of doing English. And it has certain benefits, like you might write a top screenplay or what have you, but it also is still part of coming to understand the writers and stuff that came before us and are around us now. And I suppose I think about that. I think there are some of these strands of English which haven't lasted. Okay, I feel a bit dodgy saying this, I feel a bit dodgy being filmed, but it seems to me that cultural studies, for example, as an idea, as a discipline, has not lasted. It's not lasted because its political commitments seem to have failed, there hasn't been global revolution, okay, and I'm so bad saying that, we had a riot the other day, but there you are, and I feel also that, and I feel very uncharitable saying this, a lot of work done in cultural studies per se is of quite a low quality. I mean, some obviously is fantastic. Okay, but some is quite a low quality. And I suppose my worry about creative writing is that it's if the work is intellectually good, and by intellectually I mean aesthetically and all those sorts of things too, if the work is good, it will thrive as a thread of English. And if the work is not good, okay, it will decline and fade away like cultural studies has. And I think that's quite I know half of you got creative writing jobs, that's quite a burden on you. To make sure the work is good, okay? Because I don't think it isn't rooted quite enough in English yet, or it will be soon, 5 or 10 years. But you know, discipline, they can come and go. I was thinking of film studies, of course, split off from English in all sorts of ways. Okay, so that was my sort of warning. Oh yeah, I meant to say, each of my 4 points about English has got a sort of a thing to do at the end. So my thing to do at the end is like keeping it in the discipline and keeping it intellectually strong. Okay? And I think that is happening. People know much more about it than I do. People are working out how to run PhDs in it better and teaching it better, all these sorts of things. So it is fine. I always have in front of my cultural studies and various things that have not worked. I'll stop there. So, second point. All right, the perennial favourite, the theory versus criticism war. Okay? The theory versus criticism war is over. Theory won. All right? That was what happened. And you could tell it won because now, well, you can tell it was in two ways. One is that everyone has to know something about sort of theory sorts of things. You can't just teach Middlemarch like you taught it 80 years ago, all right? So that's one reason. And the questions that theory asks, questions about gender and about power and about structure and all these sorts of things, and that question everybody asks quite normally without a second thought. But the second reason you can tell it's won is because the people who were most resistant to theory have now theorized their own bit of the discipline, which is sort of history of the book. Okay? That seems to me to be a resistant to theory area, which has now theorized itself really interestingly. I think that's a really, really interesting thing. I find myself talking to theory history of the book people, and some of them are really quite interesting and have interesting things to say, so that's really good.
Some of them are in the room. Yeah, I know.
But I was thinking about this on the bus, actually, thinking about whether I should be... The cultural studies thing was worrying me as well, and I was wondering about whether I should say sort of, you know, how I felt or not. But, I mean, you know, okay. I think everyone will admit there are boring bits in English all over, and I've been to one or two very boring history of the book things. I've been to some very, very boring theory things as well. But I suppose I want to say underneath the who won theory of criticism is a much deeper war in English, which has been always going on, which is war, again, I was trying to find this Roland Barthes quote, but I couldn't find it, war between formalism and historicism. This war has been going, I mean, this is a sort of a conflict which has never been resolved. And you could write a very interesting history of English in Germany, Britain and France, and America, of course, saying, you know, which forces, the forces of formalism or forces of historicism, were in dominant now. I guess one of the things that's happened in English in the last 15 years, apart from creative writing, has been the sort of really powerful growth of historicism coming out of new historicism, to the point sometimes where colleagues at the University of London, but not at this college or at Royal Holloway, you know, talk about themselves as being historians, when you think, yeah, but you're in an English department. What sort of historian is that in an English department? Okay. And so that seems to be very powerful. But by the same token, there are lots of formalists out there thriving. There's a whole movement you might know about called the new aestheticism. There's a guy called Peter de Bollo, wrote a fantastic book called Art Matters about 10 years ago. It's a really, really good book about art. And you can see it's one of those books that's, I always think about it, it's like, it's made of like material out of a black hole. It's much denser than it looks, okay? Like Adorno, all right? So it's, and of course Adorno is one of those great figures thinking about art, not art for art's sake, but art as a thing in itself. And so there is a sort of anti-historicist movement going on. So here's a sort of interesting balance. And I suppose what I want to say about that is, I'm a hopeless dilettante, as people who know me know, and I flit from being formalistic-y to historicist-y as the mood takes me. Okay, so you haven't got to be one or the other, but I do think that formalist versus historicist is a very powerful shape of argument that's continually going on. And I think that part of our job as intellectuals and academics is to watch that and see how it develops and see how these debates go. Okay, it's always worth knowing what goes on in Shakespeare studies. Because Shakespeare studies is like Paris. When Paris catches a cold, all of Europe sneezes. Or is it the other way around? When Paris sneezes, all of Europe catches a cold. I forget. But what goes on in Shakespeare studies pretty soon filters through to the other strong areas of the discipline, through to Victorians, modernists, 20th century, and so on. So it's well worth talking to your Shakespeareans to know what's going on. Although they're always a bit mad, it always seems to me, but they'll pass over that too. Third thing, I suppose, is... How much more have I got? Okay, I won't too much longer. Is what people call discipline envy, but I wonder we might call discourse envy. Okay, so one of the things about English, about not having a solid core, Or, sorry, one second. Not having a solid core, or like historians, not having a solid craft training. Like all historians have to go through their craft training. They get locked in the archives for 3 years and they learn how to be historians. Because we don't have that, it seems to me we're very envious of other disciplines. We're envious of history, particularly, and we're envious of psychoanalysis. We're envious of all these other disciplines that seem to offer sorts of things. And so you find people saying, "Oh yeah, I'm an English department, but really I do psychoanalysis, or I'm really do history." And the bit of me, very old-fashioned bit, goes, "Well, you do English. What are you doing?" But in fact, there is this sense of always constantly pushing the boundaries and doing other things, and that's a really good sense. And that's still, I suppose, 10 years ago there was a whole thing about literature and law, and everyone in English is very envious of people doing law. Okay. And I suppose one of the things I think about that is that that's an ongoing thing. And the reason why I'm called discourse envy is because it's now, with discussions about impact and a quite right demand that we expose ourselves more, we also get sort of envy of people on TV and people on the radio. Okay? And we think, that's another bloody historian on the radio. How did that happen? Okay? And I think that that's... yeah, of course, lots of poets and writers and so on got the radio. That's a good thing, okay. But they rarely get on a radio as they rarely say, "Professor Sir Andrew Motion at Royal Holloway." They say Andrew Motion, the former poet laureate. You think, yeah, but he's at Royal. Do you know what I mean? So it's constantly elided. So I think that's a thing that we have to constantly worry about. And one of the things about English today is. And Catherine Belsey mentioned this about 10 years ago, or 5 years ago, about the public understanding of what it is we do, and getting out there and doing things that are Englishy and impactful and recognised. And that's something else we have to do. And one of the ways of doing that is by, I'm sorry to say this, like cultivating people in the media. That sounds really awful, but it's not that hard to do. Okay, it's not that hard to contact people in the media and know who they are, okay, and to pitch them short things from time to time. In fact, when I say it's not that hard to do, it's really, really easy to do. And newspapers are desperate for copy. And if you pitch them a good idea, I'm happy to tell you how to do it another time, okay, you'll get 300 words in The Guardian and a cheque for £75. Okay, it's really easy to do, and I think it's really important. Important because of impact, but important because of keeping us sort of going. But it leads me to think about what is it that we do? And I'm not going to say here's the secret pure thread of English, but there is a really weird thing. I work a lot with historians and a lot with philosophers, and they just don't read as well as we do. It's really hard to explain what I mean by that. And again, after looking for Ben's fantastic article, I was looking for my copy of The History Man by Malcolm Bradbury, where the lascivious lecturer in history is trying to seduce the pure lecturer in English. And he says, quotes a line from Blake saying, "You're better to stifle a baby than that its wishes..." I can't remember the line is now, so I couldn't find the book. And he quotes this line from Blake, and she just interprets it completely differently and leaves him sort of stunned, because she can read it much better than he can. So when you hang out with people who do these other things, you do remember that we do this reading better than they do. It's quite hard to sort of say exactly what it consists of, but it is a sort of... I'm going to tell an embarrassing story about Lady Gaga now. So I was in the pub with some friends of mine who aren't academics, but all very clever, and we're talking about Bad Romance by Lady Gaga, which I'm going to teach next year to my theory students. And... somebody said, "Oh, it's one of these songs, it's just like, it's an unhappy love affair, da-da-da-da." And I said, no. In fact, if you read the lyrics, or read the lyrics properly, it's quite a happy love affair, because it's about writing a novel, which is like a bad romance. And a bad romance, like a Mills and Boone, all right, doesn't end unhappily like Wuthering Heights. A bad romance ends with getting married and a big white meringue dress and, you know, all lovely and fluffy. And then my friend looked at me as if I was mad, of course. But I still stick by the sense that just by reading it, you can do interesting and more complicated and difficult things. And in areas of history, for example, where there's lots of testimony or stuff written or novels, that's quite an important thing to be able to do. So I think my point for things to do for that is not to worry, because there is something we do really well, okay? And two, public facing, making friends with people in the media, okay? And so my last thing is my most depressing one, really, which is that I was at a lovely conference in Reading in the spring about literary criticism, and Joe McDonough, who's a professor of English here, did a first degree in Cardiff, so educated in that 80s theory sort of fashion, gave a really good paper about like the institutions of English. And one of the things, I was a good Foucauldian, I'm very interested in institutions and how they work and what they do, and they're sort of strange, but they're like the form of the discipline, do you know what I mean? Not the content, but the form of it. So, what's going to happen? Well, with the Brown Report, no one quite knows, cuts, fees, I don't know any better than anybody else, really. I think we know that some places are probably going to go to the wall. I think we know that the arts are going to contract. I think English less so. It's very, very, very popular. It's the most popular arts humanities subject by far, much more popular than history even. And employers like it. One of the first things, the Subject Centre did a report on employability. I went to CQ where they reported on it, and I sat in with all these famous professors, and the woman who the Subject Centre had asked to write the report said, employers think English is a Premier League subject. And all these professors around me were going, what English? What I teach? That can't be right. They thought it's supposed to be all fussy. And I just thought, this is really interesting. And they went on all the things that English did, communications and employability and processing information and all those sorts of things. And I was really, really impressed and came away feeling very fluffy about it. So I think that the institutions, from that, I think that I'm not that worried about English as a discipline. I'm worried about some colleagues' jobs, and I'm worried about institutions, about universities, but I think discipline is quite strong. But I think one of the things that we have to do, is my point, is to watch, but for us, for doing English in higher and further education, is to watch what goes on at A-level like hawks. Okay, like hawks. Because A-level is where that's the gate between secondary education and us. Okay, it determines how good our students are when they come, what they do, what they expect. Okay, and the English A level is the content is not in change at the moment, but the institutions that run it are in change. The Qualifications and Curriculum Development Authority, the QCDA, is being burnt in the bonfire of the quangos. Okay. Which means that I think they're thinking that all the things about changing A-levels are going to be brought in-house to the Department for Education. So they'll be run by civil servants, not people who know anything about education. I think A-level is going to take a lurch to a weird, more traditional way of doing things. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing in itself, okay? It might be quite good to read more Dryden than Graham Swift. But by the same token, a lurch to the more traditional side often means a lurch away from educational expertise. Okay, so it might be, if it went more traditional and it was all done by educational experts, I would feel slightly happier. Okay, but it might be done by ministerial fiat, which is not quite the same thing. So I think one of the things that we have to do, one of the things we've been very bad at as a discipline, is watching what goes on at A level. I think that's a really, really important thing. That's one thing about the institutions. The second thing, and I'm going to stop after I said this about institutions, is I edited I'm going to boast now, I edited a huge encyclopedia of theory, and I couldn't get any Americans to write about Stanley Fish, okay, because Stanley Fish is a bad smell in America. It was really weird, I couldn't get anyone to write about him. So I had the great joy of reading lots of Stanley Fish. And I read lots of his early stuff, his middle stuff, his late stuff, and his prose just gets funnier and funnier and better, and I guess because it is one step away, it's slightly removed from my own experience. And so I wrote a thing about Stanley Fish, just praising him, saying how clever and interesting he was. And the American over-editor said, you can't possibly say this, and maybe change it to a much more negative nuance piece. I was quite cross about it. But one of the books I read by Stanley Fish was about university politics. He'd been dean of, not Chicago, where was he dean of? He was dean of a huge...
Duke.
Was he dean of Duke? Did he go, was he dean of somewhere else afterwards? Dean of Duke.
Chicago or
some
Western?
Somewhere with the University of Illinois. Anyway, he was dean of an enormous, and he had a.
Oh, yes, the University of Illinois.
Yeah, that's right. And eventually he left because he fell out with the local legislature. Okay, so with the politicians, and he said, look. And I think it's quite germane to where we are now. He said, look, you can't persuade these people that English or any of the arts and humanities are good on their own terms, on the economic terms. You're always going to lose that argument, even when you're right. Okay? Because I deeply believe English does phenomenal social good for the country and economic good. And you can, sorry, and I'm footnoting now, and you can measure that by going on a tube train and seeing how many people read books in 2010, in 2000, in 1990, in 1980, and you just see more people reading books, okay? So, and I think that's to do with there being more English graduates and books being a part of what we do. So, I've got lost now. So, even though you can just make economic, politicians won't listen to it, he says. They won't listen to arguments about reason, okay? All politicians listen to are arguments about politics. That's their genre, that's what they do. And if you want to fight them, you have to do politics with them. You can't take a moral high ground. You can't say this. You have to go and fight them on committees. You have to go and fight them in meetings. You have to go and do hand-to-hand dirty politics stuff all the time. And I think that's, I was quite sort of upset by that in a way, thinking, you know, no one listens to reason. But by the same token, thinking, well, okay, if that's what you've got to do, that's what we've got to do. So in terms of institutions, I think one of the things we have to do is to be involved in institutions. And I'm not saying it has to be always fighting and breaking windows and so on, but involved in them, being on committees and being on academic boards and making sure we have our say. Okay, because the only way that we're going to be heard is when we talk. Does that make sense? Yeah? I mean, no one's going to listen to us otherwise. So you only win politics by doing politics. So that's my last thing. So those are my thoughts about English. I'm sorry it wasn't more intellectual, but there you go. It's Friday afternoon. I feel bad about what's about history of the book now, sorry.
Well, yeah, let me just address.
Please, that. Yeah, I'm so sorry.
Okay, so I love what you said about, the creative writers on the one hand, confidence because they're creative writers.
Yeah, yeah.
Example.
Of a discipline. Drama students have it.
Drama students.
Yeah, yeah.
For me,
yeah.
Being a history of the book person,
yeah, yeah.
The history of the book is a key to empowering students because find ways of giving them projects that are original research.
Yeah, I hear that.
The position that I'm currently in, we're telling students who are doing independent research projects, oh, don't worry, it doesn't have to be original research. And my mantra is, yeah, but it can be. And here's how, you know. So
yeah,
I think that's a way of giving literature students, traditional literature students, the kind of confidence that you might see in creative writing students.
Yeah, no, I totally hear that. In fact, and I do know of all those sort of projects where you, you get students to edit things published 1829 and so on. Yeah, no, I think that's really good. That's absolutely right. And I guess as a contemporary literature person, my comparison to that is when you students doing a dissertation on a contemporary writer. And they say, but there's no secondary criticism. And I say, well, that's fantastic. It's up to you to sort of write it. And they go, oh, and they're both scared and excited at the same time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I hear that. And I suppose what was on my mind about it was that often I went to a big... actually, I'm not saying that in public. when there are... I do see that different sorts of printing blocks from the 1830s are important in scholarship, okay? But I'm not disputing that, but it for somebody for whom it's not burningly important, it's very, very boring and seems very much angels dancing on a pinhead. And I guess perhaps one of the things about history of the book is that it does very easily deteriorate into a scholasticism. Gosh, just these terms of abuse from the 15th century. It's turned into a sort of scholarship for its own sake. And I sort of think, well, what's the role of that in a university? What's critical about that? Now, I see also that it does do very other sorts of things. And it is very interesting to compare different drafts of The Wasteland or more sophisticated things. But I guess that one of my fears is it It gives up what's critical about criticism or theory to a historicism. I mean, it is very strongly historical. That does empower students, and I do see that how the angels dance dependent is an important question. I worry about it. I also want to know why. And I feel the same with theorists too. When someone says to me, it's of vital importance to know whether Levinas wrote this in the late 62 or early 63, okay, I remember having been very cross-roused with people about this matter, okay, it's very important in terms of when he rethought his key concepts. It doesn't matter that much. And it loses its perspective. Does that make sense? Sorry for... Oh, I feel bad. I'm going to be harassed now by historians of the book forever.
Oh, no. It helped me to think about it.
Yeah.
There's a question about this intellectual content in creative writing.
And
that it's... I totally agree. I think it should be seen as another way of thinking, actually. Thinking with the imagination, like with the tactile qualities of language. And at the same time, it sort of feeds into kind of ongoing debate, I suppose. It's always there in creative writing in the English department context.
Mm-hmm.
What is the intellectual content? To give a specific example, one of my colleagues who teaches creative writing and is really wholly a writer, you know, he doesn't come from an academic background in that sense, we have these elements in our assessment of, they have to write commentaries, live and crit, basically.
Yeah.
And he's kind of very uncomfortable with it, and sort of thinks, well, this is creative writing course, And I think it's going to be really important, actually, for creative writers to be able to articulate the integration of that kind of content with the writerly stuff. Because to me, they should be on one, they are a continuum, good reading, good writing, all that sort of stuff, that fundamental principle. I just wondered if you had any more thoughts on that sort of issue, or whether you've come across these debates about that balance.
How he can do his singing, even though he can't sing like he used to. And he has this moment of critical self-reflection. He actually sees himself in a shop window. And it's by thinking about how he can do it that allows himself to carry on being creative. And I suppose one of the things about the critical stuff that creative writers write is it's a way of... When you read writers writing about how they wrote their next thing, how did you get from, what led you to write Madame Bovary? Okay, it's precisely because they've worked through it in a way we'd see as being critical reflection, what it was they were doing. Or, why is your sub-Tolkienian fantasy not getting published by a publisher? Let me go and think away about how fantasy might be in the context of writing fantasy and why Tolkien might be good or bad, yada, yada, yada. And then you'd be able to write a newer sort of sub-Tolkien fantasy that would be attractive to... Well, that's what Harry Potter is, isn't it? I mean, it's sort of... She's retooled several fantasy tropes to sell. And that's an act of phenomenally clever critical reflection. There's a great line about the man who wrote Jaws saying the most profitable sentence in the 1970s was, "What if sharks became territorial?" So I suppose that's why I like the critical thing. And in terms of it being a discipline of English,
I'm quite happy with that, by the way.
I've
got an English literature background.
Yeah.
And I'm late into writing, so I've got it.
I would really hate to lose them. And I also find myself quite wedded to the idea that you could only write if you've read lots of stuff. I think there are what Ben would call, I'm sure as you talked about them, sort of tribal issues about creative writers and literary critics. They didn't like you.
No, I mean just in the debates in my department.
Yeah.
That's a debate.
Well, I won't deny the fact that I feel, one of the things I tell my graduate students who are working on interesting literary theory, contemporary literature topics, I say, if you wrote some short stories and got your friend to publish some of your poetry in a photocopy journal, that would do your job prospects no harm at all. That's very cynical to say that, but I think people do think, I feel very strongly for my graduate students, I think they're not going to get they've halved their chance of getting jobs because the jobs go into creative writers. And of course, there are lots of fantastic creative writers, but years ago, when creative writing was just beginning, there were lots that weren't. And I also, I suppose, privately, I would happily compare an interesting first monograph about magical realism to a first collection of poems. And in my own little head, I would evaluate them, and perhaps the poems might be better, or the monograph might be better. Yeah. But the market doesn't do that, you know what I mean? So that's one area of resentment. And of course, it's very hard. Yeah. If you spent your years working on, this is the same as literary theory in the 80s and 90s, if you spent your life working on Middlemarch, on George Eliot, to suddenly find that everything you knew about George Eliot is overthrown, if you spent your life working on post-structuralist theory, which is all radical and cool and exciting and overthrowing things, and you discover that somebody writing poems is doing even more overthrowing, you have to do quite a lot of mind work not to be resentful about that.
Maybe that's why
we're in the
squeeze.
Well, No, but those things are played out institutionally, aren't they, very often?
But just thinking about your comments about institutions.
Yeah.
It's also interesting to think about how creative writing programs and English programs get caught up in institutional imperatives. So that I think there's quite a lot of variety in the UK in terms of whether it's creative writing is housed within English or is it separate from English? Is it in humanities? Is it in arts? Part of that, to again, a cynical perspective is because PVCs and deans have seen creative writing as a cash cow and have just said, right, do creative writing. We want it, and have not thought through the pedagogical imperative of it, which has really not done creative writing itself any favors, but has also created tension when it's landed in English and given to people who are not necessarily trained. But that, I think, itself is very much in flux and in flow.
Yeah.
And so I don't know that it's either or, where it's always been separate in the US and it's always been integrated in the UK. I think it has hobbled the development up to now. I feel like there's a flourishing and a real sort of both intellectual sort of neediness and feistiness to how creative writing is being done. And also a deep-seated interest in the pedagogy of creative writing, which I think is having when we hear it in this room, and just over today, that it's having a deadening effect on those tensions and those antagonisms between English and creative writing, the fact that many of you have feet in both camps. You are going to relate to your more senior colleagues very, very differently, and that will also be a very different response in turn to the work that you're doing in the classroom.
No, that's absolutely right.
Kind of in response to all of these things, I think one of the things we were talking about earlier was the essay and how that's kind of fundamental to the benchmark for English. Those benchmarks that we looked at, 2000, it said essay is fundamental to the course, and then 2007 it said writing, informed writing, extended discursive. Yeah. So I thought that was a really interesting fluctuation. And what I also think is quite interesting is looking at the kind of impact, I suppose, that creative writing may have on the essay or on the informed writing. And one of the things, and vice versa, one of the things with creative writing that I try to not hammer out, but kind of not necessarily overheard, is the tension, especially with first year students, for this really kind of subjective expression, and you kind of go, not all poetry particularly is about your boyfriend. So, and I think, I think the critical reflection is one of those areas where we start to say, actually, if you get a little bit of distance from that really, really subjective engagement, then you start to look at what the poetics are doing, etc. And likewise, but I think the thing that, so that's how kind of the literature side informs the creative writing side. But then again, the vice versa would be that I'm quite resistant to modes of essay writing, and I didn't know my colleagues, that strive for objectivity. and kind of aesthetic judgment with that. And I like to play with that kind of tension between, you know, as a critic, you know, between you know, my I suppose response to a piece, you know, and how that can manifest in the writing. So, and I'm wondering if you know, going back to some of these territorial battles, is that a, you know, is that one of these kind of grand when a creative writing mode might encourage a use of a kind of I position in a critical text, and you know, then you're starting to kind of really I don't know, maybe go into contentious ground. So I think I'm trying to say that I think they inform each other, but then you know, some creative writers might be very resistant to the criticality, whereas some
But again, that's the same with this. I mean, the students, some of them say, I was always taught to say I think in essays, and I'll say, oh, my teachers told me never to say I think. And that reminds me of various things. One is, of course, the terrible irony, which is the better they're taught at A level, the more unhappy they are with us. It's a really weird thing. They're really well taught at A level, they have sort of bond with their teacher, and they feel loved and looked after, and they see us at the far end of a long lecture theatre, you know, and they maybe see us, at most institutions, you know, they don't have one-to-one contact, and so they feel unloved and far away, and ideally that grows into a sense of their own independent learning. So one of the other things I've heard in English is an increase in independent learning, and sometimes it creates an alienation they never get over. But the other thing I was thinking about, especially about essays, is there's also, again, when I was thinking about what's changing in English, I think one of the things that hasn't changed, isn't changing, is something not extended discursive prose. At the other end, like our end of it, is the monograph. And you know, it's still the case that English is a monograph subject, and you write your monograph, you get your job. I mean, not quite like that, but as we all know in this room, you know, the one of the key ways of getting from the big pile of rejected CVs to the pile of long-listed CVs is to have your monograph out or coming out, your PhD monograph, you know, and that's still the sort of the gold standard for English, and I don't see that changing at all. And one of the reasons I'm ashamed to say I don't see it changing is because I'm very happy. I'm not like my friend saying change. You know, I like change. Change is interesting and good as long as you do the mind work around it. But I still think that a monograph is the measure of academics' work in this discipline. And you know, I think it's. I know how hard it is writing. It makes your brain melt. But it just. I think that's the measure of it. That sounds really snobby and awful, but that's sort of how I feel quite deeply. And I don't see that changing at all. Sorry, that's killed the conversation.
Can I pick up something, your Wittgenstein metaphor?
Yeah.
Creative thread, all these things. I believe firmly that is true, but I think one could also, given the world enough and time, actually articulate what some core of this thing was, without going into an essential team. But I think the other side of it being a discipline made up of a number of strands is the political thing, of just how extremely different it is to explain to the outside world. Whether because of Simon Sharma and Niall Ferguson and all the rest of them, on the whole, I think it's, you know, it's gross generalizations, but I speak as an old adult education hat. It is reasonably easy for people to understand what history does. It relates to all those things they're interested in. Like Daniel, you know, us and Johnson having some bookshop about military history, which is sort of overtaken history. I mean, W.H. Smith's in Edinburgh, like I did the other day, you know, military history. But it is actually quite hard to explain what English is.
Yeah, that's
for
true.
For the very same reasons that the other side of the strength of the brain.
And the thing is that whenever you do, you slide into some other discourse. So if you start turning it, say...
Yeah, you start talking about sliding into discourse.
That's what I say. You say that it's about thinking about how art reflects us. That's a sort of philosophical sort of discourse. And it's true also for historians of art and everything. And if you say it's about reading poetry, people say, well, no one cares about that. And if you, do you know what I mean? So as soon as you try and defend what it does, it's really, really hard. But one of the things I think that, and I guess it's still a legacy of Leavis in a sense, the sense that, you know, everyone does have a sense of what English, that most people have a rough sense of what English sort of is. Even though they can't pin it down, they say, no, it's about reading books, it's about reading Shakespeare. And it's very, very hard to defend. Or you say, if you say it's about our heritage, you sound like a historian. So
you think about the thing about reading, which I thought was actually quite interesting, that saying it helps you be well doesn't
really. Yeah.
But I thought that was interesting.
It's really true. I've only just come to think about it in the last 2 or 3 years. Partially through my friends who aren't academics, and partially through my friends who are academics who are in different disciplines, and you think we just read in a much more intense kind of way. Or if you ever try to, another very good party trick to do, actually, is in London on the tube. If you're with someone and there's a poem on the tube, and you do a close deconstructive reading of it to make it say the opposite of what it appears to say, and you try and explain that to your non-academic friend you're with on the tube, it's always great, because they go, no, it just says it's really sad these young men died in the First World War. You say, no, it doesn't say that. It says something completely different. And they go, oh. But I think it's really interesting that's, I mean, historians have their craft and so on, and philosophers have their learning how to argue. And there is something about the I hesitate to say close reading. There's something about the reading which is really, really interesting. Well, that must go for creative writers as well, mustn't it? I don't know about there being a core of English. I think that's just a strand of things that we can do. We're reading Derrida and not more Milton. So theory people like me get to complain that creative writing students are not reading any Freud or Marx or Lacan. Do you see what I mean? And it's exactly the same complaint.
Well, it might just be
a change. Yeah. I mean, it's good for disciplines to change. I've got no. I was just talking about the English and gone. Essential English.
Can I just ask a question about the kind of sense that you have in this, that we're all really rather scared about, that they might be kind of civil servants of people in Whitehall who are setting an agenda for
A-levels
and Victorian, so I have no objections to people saying to be interviewed.
No.
The kind of canonical text that we value or have traditionally, but I am fearful of this, as you suggested, coming from on high without being integrated, without being kind of from within the within us, within academia. And I was also kind of wondering, along with this kind of discourse of, you know, back to the camp, is also alongside it, Michael Goeing is also talking about higher education. Being about getting a job at the end of it. And it's all about what you do after you've done the degree. And learning for the sake of learning seems to kind of have somehow very, very quickly gone.
Disappeared, yeah.
And that frightens me in kind of...
Should I talk about the institutions available very quickly and then talk about the answer to a question? So you have to remind me about the second bit because I'll forget. The way A-level works, or way A-level used to work, is that there are three, in England, there are three exam boards. There's one in Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland as well, but in England there are three exam boards. And they used to have a regulator, the QCDA, Qualifications Curriculum Development Authority, there. And the regulator set the regulation for what an A-level should look like. So you had to read 9 texts in A-level English and yada, yada, yada. And then the exam boards would write a specification that met basic regulation from the QCA, QCDA, okay, but also had sexy things to attract people. So one would have, then the exam boards have to sell their A levels to schools, basically. So some say ours is more coherent, or ours has more sex in it, or ours has more Shakespeare in it. Okay, but they all met the regulation from the QCDA. So the exam companies are run by evil capitalists type thing. But the people who actually do the examiners are basically nice, decent teaching people, and they want to write interesting specs for students to do. Okay, and the specs were regulated by the QCDA, and so the QCDA was able to say in 2005, for example, that you were doing 7 texts for A level, and now you're doing 9. Okay, or you were doing these texts this way, and now we're going to make sure you do some text. You make sure we compare. You have to compare at least 3 of these texts. Or the thing that I'm most proud of, you have to do 1 post 1990 bit of literature, because I made them do that. I feel it was slagged off in the Daily Mail. I thought that was me. I made them do that. Great. But now that's been abolished, no one knows who's going to set the regulations. And it may be people who think it's a great idea to teach Dryden and Middlemarch and so on, and it may well be a good idea to teach these things. But you can see, can't you, that if you say you must teach 3 Dickens novels and a George Eliot novel, that's going to kill an A-level. Do you see what I mean? Not because they're not works of genius, because they are, but because there's no time to do Chaucer or Shakespeare or other stuff. And that's what I mean about the expertise. Okay, so if civil servants do it, they're good at being civil servants, they're no good at being educationalists. So that's a complicated ecosystem that we don't really know about, that we have to find out about in order to do things to and with. Okay, and so I would recommend everyone to try and talk to people in that world. So your second thing about the learning for learning's sake. Okay, I'm not worried about that for this reason. I'm worried about poor people not going to university, and I'm worried about all those things. But I'm not worried about learning for learning's sake, because learning for learning's sake always happens by accident. Universities were for creating lawyers and priests, okay, which are both sort of technical skills. Priest and technical skill, but you know what I mean. And all the learning and scholarship always happens by accident, okay? Because nobody outside universities really cares about universities, and they don't care about learning and scholarship. So it always happens by accident, and we love it, because it's the thing that is really important. But for our students, and I say that education has 2 bits to it. It has this learning, scholarship, making your mind better, making you a better person thing that is totally intangible, and it's teaching you skills, and that's why you're losing marks for not doing your footnotes properly. Okay, and I've got no problem with saying we teach them skills. And I've got no problem with saying, I was giving my essays all day yesterday, and to every single student, every 10 minutes, I was saying, what we do is we convey all these ideas buzzing around up here about Salman Rushdie, or about the Large Hadron Collider, or about types of frogs, whatever it might happen to be, and we teach you in universities to process all those ideas into a report or an essay or a thing. And that's what employers want you to be able to do. So in a way, the scholarship and the learning for learning's sake and what employers want turn out to be the same thing. It's turning information into ways of understanding information. So deep down, it's the same thing. So deep down, whatever the politicians say, one, it doesn't matter because it's never mattered, because we know what it is anyway, and 2, we do it anyway. And perhaps in English, I feel quite passionate about this, perhaps in English we need to be much more upfront, like the subject centre's report, about why employers like what we do and what it is that we do. Sorry, that was a rant, not an answer.
I think that's really true and really interesting.
Can I say one more thing?
It's always been back to its origins.
Yeah.
Sorry,
can I just rant one more thing? Sorry. I mean, the other thing is that 17% of English graduates go to financial services, and 9% become teachers, and that's been stable for a long, long time. And it's fine for people to go to sell mortgages. Why would they not? Do you know what I mean? I'm not troubled by people becoming lawyers and so on. It's lots of, you know. But the other thing I want to say is that again, it's part of being upfront about what we do. Everybody in this room, creative writers and researchers and so on, have all these. I sound like Thatcher, so I'm sorry for saying it, all these entrepreneurial skills. Because doing research is intellectual entrepreneurship. Okay, you find something that's really interesting, you find what's not been done, you find the holes in it, and then you fill those holes. That's just like setting up a bagel trolley in Brixton High Street. Okay, to sell something. It's exactly the same bit of thinking. All right, and it's about, and what business people want is people who question categories and question concepts and think through things, and that's what we teach our students to do. So again, what we teach them to do and what business want turn out to be the same thing. And because we're stuck on saying learning for learning's sake, which we all love, and God knows I love it too, we lose sight of the fact that we have quite strong arguments for explaining what we do to people. I'm not explaining what we do to people, but explaining the sort of benefits for them.